I invite you to stand with me, if you would, for the presenting of the colors. Please be seated.
This is the 5:30 News on KPAX, Montana's news leader.
I'm Jill Valley. And I'm Dennis Bragg. Tonight, many mourning the loss of a 19-year-old Missoula man killed while fighting a wildlands fire near Seeley Lake yesterday afternoon.
The young man was loved and respected by many, and his loss, another reminder of just how dangerous wildland firefighting can be. MTN's Don Fisher joined us in the studio with more on the tragedy. Don.
Jill, Dennis, 19-year-old Trenton Johnson was working for Grayback Forestry in Missoula when they were dispatched to help with a fire in the Lolo National Forest. During the fight, he was struck by a fallen tree and was later pronounced dead at the hospital. Grayback Forestry President Mike Wheelock traveled from Merlin, Oregon to Missoula Thursday morning to deliver the sad news and offer some details on what led to Johnson's untimely death. Wheelock says a 10-person team was dispatched to a half-acre lightning-caused wildfire in the Seeley Lake Ranger District around 10:30. While fighting the fire, four crew members were in the area where the tree fell. Those who were there say it happened in an instant.
Some of the wording I heard was fast as a lightning bolt, and they just heard a crack, and that was it. The three of them were able to get out of the way, and Trenton did not.
Wheelock says Johnson was working with an experienced crew who followed all required procedures, including proper communication, escape routes, and lookout points. This was only the second fire Johnson had worked on in his young career, assisting with a Utah fire earlier this summer. Johnson was a standout athlete at Hellgate High School and a second-year student at Montana State University. Wheelock says the team is obviously taking the loss very hard.
Grayback's crews up here are very tight and close-knit, and I know they're just all devastated by this. And we go to fires all over the United States. We all wear green and yellow, and one falls, the whole community comes together. It doesn't matter whether you're contract or federal employee.
Wheelock says, unfortunately, falling trees injure and even kill many firefighters each year. He says it serves as another reminder of the sacrifice that is made to fight these dangerous disasters.
We just ask that you keep the family and in your prayers and the fellow workers and all the firefighters that are out there right now on the line.
The incident will be investigated internally and also by OSHA in the coming weeks. Wheelock says plans for a community memorial service are still in progress. Please stick with KPAX on air and online for updates. Jill?
All right, Don, thank you. Now condolences are pouring in for Montana's elected officials about the tragic death of Trenton Johnson. Governor Steve Bullock said today, quote, "Firefighters dedicate their lives each day to ensuring the safety of our communities. Lisa and I send deepest condolences to the family, friends, and colleagues of firefighter Trenton Johnson. He will forever be remembered as a brave man who exemplifies the courage and selflessness of all of our first responders." Montana Senator John Tester said today, quote, "This is a tragic day for Missoula and all of Montana as we mourn the loss of firefighter Trenton Johnson. His bravery and sacrifice will not be forgotten, and it's a sobering reminder that every day firefighters put their lives on the line to protect ours."
Is Jeff Valentine, and on behalf of the family today, I want to thank each one of you for making a priority to come and to celebrate Trenton's life. Like you, this week, I imagine, certainly I have felt great appreciation for our firefighters, particularly at this time of year when, like we just saw on the screen, they're putting their lives on the line. Literally, as is the reason we are gathered here today. You know, I was called and asked if I would give leadership to our time together today, and I marveled as I was thinking about it, and even online, seeing these condolences that were extended, and then finding even on a national scale that one newspaper was reporting this story. And I thought to myself that we live in this little community here called Missoula, and I was kind of marveling that while it's being reported even nationally, I did not know Trenton. And yet when I saw his picture, I thought, I feel like I should know him. I went home and I talked to my wife, and suddenly in talking together, the image came to my mind of a young 17-year-old man bent over a table saw, using that table saw in our driveway. We had contracted Marty, Trenton's dad, to do some work on the floors in our home. DJ had done some work there as well, and I remember coming home from the church here one day, and there's this young man bent over a table saw, cutting the pieces of wood and delivering them to his dad to do the work. And I still remember to this day having an impression as I spoke with him, my, what a courteous, thoughtful, warm, disciplined young man. We just never know how our lives cross and the impact that our lives will have on others. And certainly that was the case for Trenton in my life. It's to times like this that we turn our attention to comfort from God. And I'd like to be able to read to you just a few verses of Scripture which have been an encouragement to me. I think of that passage in Lamentations where the writer says, "I remember my affliction and my wandering, the bitterness and the gall. I well remember them, and my soul is downcast within me. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore I will wait for him." And then from Psalm 46, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble." And then from Isaiah 41, "So do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand. And then finally, from 2 Thessalonians, may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loved us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage your hearts and strengthen you. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, our hearts today are heavy. Lord, we are sobered by the loss of Trenton, one that we knew, one who had such a bright future in front of him. And Lord, while we have these scriptures here before us that give us reason to be encouraged, Lord, we need you. God, we need you to come and bring hope and healing. And so, Father, today as we celebrate Trenton's life, would you, God, be pleased to come into our presence and bless us with your presence. For Jesus' sake, amen.
Forever leaving. Is it too late to hide or try to be silent? All that carries is born to give. How many more times will I see what I've said? Dreaming up a life to live. Thank you.
Try and get through this. Can you hear me?
Hello.
All right.
Trenton Johnson was adopted from the Ukraine. At least that's what he would have told you if you'd just met him. He pulled that prank for upwards of a decade, finding endless joy in the prospect of people believing he'd come from such a faraway place. It never seemed to get old to him. As he did with many things in his life, Trenton managed to draw laughter and happiness from what would have been nonsense to anybody else. For whatever reason, he called every cat he ever met Rilo, and continued to call it Rilo even after he knew what its name was. Every time he rolled through a yellow light, he would kiss three fingers and touch the roof of his car for good luck. Trenton had dozens of things like this. You'd be going through everyday life, and he'd just do something, and it'd make you look at him kind of weird, and maybe you'd giggle. I have a quick story from second grade. It was the first time I'd ever been up to his cabin at Elbow Lake, and we were wrestling on one of his couches, and he was beating me really bad, despite being much smaller than I was. The activity ended when he eventually swung me around and just nailed the center of my forehead on one of the wooden sides of the couch. I had just the biggest goose egg right in the middle of my forehead, and I think Marty or Don checked me for a concussion, and it was fine. But the goose egg never actually totally healed. To this day, I can still feel a pocket of scar tissue right here. Trenton was a lot of things, but he was not a quitter. He never backed down from a challenge, and he inspired others around him to confront obstacles in the same way that he did. There was no reason he should have been able to beat me in wrestling all those years ago, but he did, because he never for a second doubted himself, which is an attitude that I've always admired and tried my best to emulate in my own life. In that goose egg he left on my head, he's given me a lifelong reminder to never quit, even if the odds are stacked against me. These are some of the most special things about Trenton. Beyond his obvious strengths in being a smart, hardworking, loyal, thoughtful, and happy person, he made life more fun with his quirky intricacies and winning attitude. He could make anything fun through pure determination and a view of his surroundings that was starkly individual to his own lens. There was rarely a hard time that Trenton couldn't make at least a little bit better just by being there and by being himself. He was unique in his own right, and in this way, Trenton was from the Ukraine, or he may as well have been. He was his own person in such a pure way that that he was invitingly foreign to everybody he got to know, because there was just no chance you'd ever met anybody like Trenton. You may as well have met somebody that had been adopted from the Ukraine. I want to offer the Johnson family my deepest condolences and thank them for asking me to speak. It's been an honor, and I feel lucky to have had Trenton as a friend.
Thank you, Chase, for that description of Trenton. I don't know if you can actually describe Trenton, but I think you captured a lot of it. And also thank you for adding some laughter to this room, because that's a lot of what this young man was about. And thank you, Jake, also for sharing your gifts. Thank everyone here for coming to share the love and the caring that Trenton really, really embodied. So I am Phil. I'm one of Trenton's uncles. And Trenton's mom, Dawn, has asked me to speak a few words on her behalf. And Dawn, I just want you to know, you know, we are all here to share our love and our caring with you. We're all here to help the family heal. And I'm trying to be very mindful that this is, in actuality, a celebration. Trenton was somebody who embodied joy. And I think we should all try to keep that in the front of our minds throughout the course of the day. So from Dawn. To my son Trenton, you are my knight in shining armor. You were there when I needed you the most. You always helped me with anything I needed. I know it was sometimes a nag, but my intentions were to make you the best man I could. Your spirit will be with me forever, a light for many to follow. And I think there's a lot of truth in that, Dawn. You know, Trenton is one of the best young men that I've ever had the pleasure to know. And you played a huge part in shaping what he was. You know, I think there are probably few of us in this room that can understand what a mother goes through in a situation like this. Dawn and Trenton shared a bond of humor, as he did. That's what he was about. So thank you, Dawn, for those words. I didn't prepare anything, but while I'm up here, I would just like to add one or two observations. And, you know, Trenton did not have a lot of time to make his mark, but those of us that spent any time with him knew that he did make an impression instantly. You've heard it before, you'll hear it in conversations later in the course of the day. He was a young man who made his mark more than once on the lacrosse field, as I witnessed as well. My two boys are Trenton's cousins. He spent a great deal of time with them and really feel that he left a lasting impression and that the qualities that he embodied, And I think they're some of the best qualities that humanity has to offer, will be carried forward in all of us that knew him. Thank you.
Well, so most of you know me either by Trenton or DJ's dad. To me, that is the ultimate honor. I'm up here to try to express myself with my thoughts about the men and women who are my children's fellow ground-pounding, tough, selfless fellowship that we know as wildland firefighters, and to talk about my son, Trenton. I was asked the other day, are you angry? I am not. There is nothing to be angry about. The personnel that trained him, worked beside him, supported him, from the knowledge that I've gathered, were the best, quickest reacting, and professional people that performed above the standards and made the correct decisions, followed protocol to try to minimize the damage and save and revive him when the tree top that fell and crushed his body had already killed him. There is no one to blame. I realized the thoughts going through the minds of everyone on the mountain, in the helicopters, the personnel working the radios, and all involved are trying to figure out what they could have done differently or better. Please, there is no answer for these questions. In time, I hope you can let that go. The treetop killed him. He was in the wrong spot at the wrong time that day. In my mind, there's a reason why a healthy, active 19-year-old was taken. He is an organ donor with blood type O negative, etc. He is making a difference to people right now. His death will cause someone to take pause and think about their future or inspire someone. The butterfly effect or ripples, I am certain, will change someone's life for the better. I hope it will make all of you think about the way you live and all the things you're doing and going to do someday. Please make sure that when you leave here today, you hug the people in your world more often, spend a little extra time with that person, or go on that trip. Life is precious and things can change so quickly. I've obviously thought about Trent in the last few days in a way that I had never thought before. As a parent, you take for granted a lot of things because you're around them all the time. You don't realize what your child has become before your very eyes. The network of friends, the achievements, the dreams, they're all part of your everyday life. Unfortunately, now there are no more tomorrows to do the things or say the things that could have been done and said. I feel Trenton and I have had unfinished business, and I know many of his friends feel the same. Going to Germany with Connor, camping in Banff with Anton and Curtis, the next game of Risk with Brandon, spending time on the river with any number of his many, many friends. Trenton had instant friends wherever he went. Needless to say that he was a nearly perfect socialite. He would listen, he would say the thing that needed to be said with the right words at the right time. He was very quick-witted with a dry, veiled humor. He would say things well beyond his years. He was very supportive of everyone. Amazingly, I, at 50 plus, would look to him for advice because he had an uncanny way of reading people and situations and quickly seeing things in the correct perspective. He would always put a positive spin on any conflict or situation. When he would call, he was so upbeat, he would make you feel good instantly, even though he just got done or was involved in a very long, tiring day. Refreshing would be the word that I would use to describe his demeanor. DJ and I were talking about how we couldn't identify his best friend. It seems all of his friends were his best friends. We also tried to think of someone that did not like him or someone that he did not like. We came up empty. He was a shining star that attracted people like a warm light on a cold, dark night. I could go on, but anyone that spent time with him knows what I mean. Over the years, I have had so many compliments about him. People would often say, "You guys raised great kids." Well, his mother Dawn and I, like the rest of you, did not get a manual. When he was young, I would have loved to have been told where the off switch was, just for a moment. I know Dawn and I just did what everyone else did, shoot from the hip and have knee-jerk reactions. He and his sister were just wired up well. They both have an amazing work ethic, are socially adjusted, and made our jobs as parents fairly easy. I attribute most of their greatness to the people we were around and they were exposed to. Like I have heard, it takes a village to raise a child. Well, we are lucky to be in a great village. All of our friends, coaches, teachers, aunts, uncles, and grandparents contributed to Trenton's awesome insight, calming effect, and just plain likability. It is truly was a cut-up, a man with integrity, honesty, and amazing empathy. Like most parents, we exposed him to many sports, swim, team, baseball, football, some game called soccer, and then lacrosse came to Missoula, and wow, he immersed himself in it. Trent was not a natural athlete, but with the tutoring of his cousins and the coaching staff of the Missoula Elite, his drive to be a team player, he was quite successful in his run with the sport. State champs all 4 years he played at Hellgate. I believe everyone on his team would call him a team player. He was recognized by his peers across the state with many all-state accolades. He was an academic success with the Natural Honor Society and got scholarships for college. He chose to go to MSU was well on his way studying to be an engineer. He was always a self-starter. He would study on his own without us having to prod him. I was amazed by him. He was his sister's best friend. They were extremely close and took great care of each other. He was loved by all that he came in contact with, and we were lucky and fortunate to have had him in our lives. Even though his memory will continue, he will be missed by us all. Thank you all for coming.
As Marty just mentioned, Trenton was an athlete and a team player. And my understanding today is that the lacrosse team, Hellgate, 4 years champions, has a presentation to make. great pictures and great music. I feel like I'm going home and downloading that guitar solo when I get back. You know, I, like you, have heard so many good things about Trenton these last couple of days. And yesterday I had the opportunity to sit with the family, and we gathered around a large table and just reflected on Trenton's life, some of the qualities and characteristics of him. You've heard so many that have been spoken of already here this afternoon. I think one moment yesterday together with the family that was so impressionable to me was at one moment Don said through tears, "He was such a good boy." It's very apparent to me that his family loved him and he loved his family. Always smiling. They said he always had sort of this dry humor, this quick wit. And I asked, are there stories that you'd like to reflect on here for a few moments of his humor? And one by one began to tell a number of stories that caused the family to laugh. One of those was when he was 6 years old, he thought he had broken his leg and he was screaming at the top of his lungs. And that's when Chris Freundes offered him a lifesaver, and he completely forgot about his so-called broken leg. He just grabbed that lifesaver and ate it. But there were stories like that as we laughed around the table. And then there was that moment of reality as we were there together, that that we're laughing here, but Trenton is not at the table. And the weight, the reality that he's not here to laugh with us. And then that unspoken question, what do we do now? What's the future going to hold without Trenton at the table? Maybe, like me, that creates some God questions for you. I mean, if God exists and if God is good, then where was God when Trenton was standing near that tree? I mean, if God knows all things and if God has all power, why didn't he stop this? Was he not aware? Or worse yet, did he not care? What seems to be missing in this whole story is God's presence. And I've wrestled with these questions. And I don't believe that there are any easy answers. But that doesn't change the fact that we have these questions. You know, my time with you is just very short here this afternoon, just a few minutes total. And so I just want to tell you a short story. There's a story in the Bible, in the Gospel of John, when Jesus had recently been killed. His disciples, you know, just couldn't believe it. His disciples were these men who had followed him around for 3 years. And they just couldn't believe it because he was such a good man. But an angry crowd had convinced local authorities that they should have Jesus killed. And so he was nailed to a cross. Again, incredible, since he was such a wonderful human being. He suffered horribly. He died, then was buried. And his disciples, who had followed him faithfully for 3 years and who were convinced that he was the answer for the world, suddenly are dealing with these very real questions. Questions like, what in the world is going on? I mean, he was perfect. He healed people. What are we to make of this? And in turn, they decided to go up into this room, and they locked themselves into this room because they literally did not know how to think about the future. I mean, they had spent years following Jesus wherever he went, and now he's just gone. And the questions come. What do we do now? What does the future hold for us? What will it be like without Jesus? It's interesting to me to read in the Bible in that story in John chapter 20, what happens as they are sitting in the midst of their uncertainty. I'll read the verse for you. When the door was locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side, the scars from his crucifixion. And the disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. And again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you." And then on another occasion, when one of the disciples was still uncertain about it all, Jesus came to them again through a locked door and said, "Peace be with you." Jesus just kept showing up, even after he died on the cross. And Marty and Don and DJ and the rest of the family, I just wish that Trenton would just come through those doors right now. I wish he would just saunter down this aisle and everything would be just okay. I wish he would just keep showing up. I wish. But I want to tell you that what I take from this story in Scripture is that those who believe in Jesus, who are his followers, he comes to them in their times of uncertainty and crisis, in the times of grieving, and he gives them his peace. For people who know Jesus, he always comes to them and gives them hope and a future, assures them that he's still in control. Even though things seem to be very out of control, he's in control. Not even death has the power over his purposes. He's aware, and he cares about Trenton. And that's what I'm believing for you today, for all of us here, that God will come to you, perhaps in some unexpected way, and give you hope and peace and a view to the future. Few of us can really comfort you as a family, but we're here today to say that we care, that we love you as a family. And I want to just offer one verse of Scripture that has helped me from time to time, and it's found in Psalm 9:10. I hope you won't forget this. And it goes like this: "The Lord has never abandoned anyone who searches for him." The Lord has never abandoned anyone who searches for him. It's that dominant theme in the Bible that when you start walking toward him, he starts running toward you. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this gift that you have given all of us in the life of Trenton. Lord, just to hear the tributes today, the comments that have been made, We recognize that in our midst was a very fine young man. And Father, it's a privilege for us today to celebrate his life, the gift that you gave all of us. And Father, we also thank you for the gift of Jesus and the hope that comes by pursuing Jesus and experiencing his peace. Father, I pray for that peace. I pray that it would be the experience of both Marty and Dawn and DJ and the rest of the extended family. That it would be an experience of each one of us in this room as we choose to pursue you. May it be our experience that we enjoy your peace. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you stand together with me? Powerful, amazing grace. I'd like to invite you to two events that are going to follow. Immediately following here in the adjacent room is a reception that's being provided, an opportunity for you to interact with others, and so we invite you to be a part of that. Also, we encourage all of you to participate in a reception that will be held at the fort at the Bella Vista Pavilion beginning at 3:00 this afternoon. Thank you so much for being here.
Creativity closer to the heart.